Hi everyone, welcome to my YouTube channel. Hope you all are doing extremely well. So today in this video we are going to do the discussion of technical MCQs as well as the coding questions that were asked in the TCS and QT exam. So make sure to watch the complete video. In this video we'll be covering the questions that were asked from 2022 batch. So of course if you are preparing for the same, this video is going to be very helpful for you. But before proceeding further in the video, make sure to subscribe our channel if you haven't subscribed the channel till now, and also be a part of our Telegram channel. I hope that you have done both of these things. So let's proceed with the video. The first question that we have got is that which argument is passed to fflush? So just think about it and pause the video, think about it, and then resume the video to check your answer. I hope that by now you have thought your answer. Well, the correct answer for this one will be option B. Let's have a look on our next question. So what will be the output for the below? Enter your answer only as numeral. So basically what happened in case of TCS, like there will be some MCQs as well as some questions will be like this one. So here you have been given the code. You have to determine the output. Basically you have to write your output in the given box. So there will be no option available. So if your answer is wrong, that is wrong. You don't have any option or like some kind of hint that we usually have in case of MCQs, right? So yeah, here let's see int x equal to 1 by 2. So 1 by 2, if you're going to do, it will give you 0.5, right? But as of now, this x is what? Int. So in case of integer, this decimal thing will be eliminated. So only 0 is going to be stored in x. Now here we are simply doing the comparison that if x equal 0.5, so you can see x is holding the value 0. So obviously that is not equal to 0.5. So obviously this one will be printed. So here what we are having is that is simply print x into 2. So what is the value of x? 0. So 0 into 2 is going to give you what? 0. Hence 0 will be your answer. Well, the question was pretty easy, so I don't think that I have to explain more on it. Right, next question is this one. Okay, so this is also an output based question. So you know, like always, the execution of a program is started from the main function. Let us start it from here. Now we are here we can see we are taking the object of this test outer class, right? So we are taking an object of that. Okay, so we are making an object of this inner class that is present in that test outer class. Now you can see this is our object obj. Now this obj is calling the function message. So this is calling that function. Now here we are having that data is data. So you can see the data has been provided here itself. Data variable has been provided here itself. So that is present in the parent class. So obviously the output of this one is going to be data is 30. So the questions are not going to be very difficult. It's just the basic concepts based question will be there. So if your basic concepts are clear, you'll be able to solve them. Coming to our next question. So what is the name of the method that examines a particular data entity and determines what elements need to be associated? So what will be the answer for this one? Entity relationship diagram. So entity relationship diagram do help us in that achieving that particular task. Our next question is that which operator cannot be overloaded. So you know that operators can be overloaded, even though there are some operators which cannot be overloaded. So here are the options given to you. You have to determine that which one cannot be overloaded. Well, this is also an easy one. We know that this operator, that is scope resolution operator, that cannot be overloaded. Okay, here's our next question. Select the correct code for opening a file for writing in binary mode. So these are the options given. Now for this also, option C will be the correct answer, that this is the mode, like this is the correct code for opening a file for writing in binary mode. Okay, here W is basically denoting write and B is for binary. Okay, which of the following function is used to accept a string with white spaces? So you know, like if you're using scanf and if you are using a string with white spaces, so it just first part of, let's suppose we are having the fox jump. So the da is going to be considered and the rest will be eliminated. But when you want to consider the whole string along with the spaces, in that case, we do use what? We use getters function. We use getters function. Hope that is clear. Here comes our next question that, okay, this is the code given you in Java and you have to determine it what will be the output when the options are provided to you. So let's see, we'll be starting from main function. So that is here. Now we are providing an object of this main class, that is main class is the object. Now we are calling main class dot sort. So do we So you can see this is the function that we are calling. Main, this object is calling main class dot sort. So here, first of all, we are taking an array list. To this array list, we are adding elements. First of all, we added mango, then grapes. So mango is there, and then grapes is there. Now we are simply taking an iterator to iterate on our array list. So we are simply printing till the time this iterator has some elements. So first of all, you know, like iterator will check. The iterator dot has next, you can see we are having mango. So first of all, mango will be printed, and then grapes will be printed. So mango printed, grapes printed, right? So option A will be the correct answer. And after this, you can say they have sorted, but it's of no use. Like it won't be shown in the output because you know, like we have printed before this sorting thing. If they were about to print after sorting, then the answer should be grapes mango, because accordingly in alphabetical order, G would come before M. But as of now, what do we have? That this sorting is we are doing later on after printing. So mango grapes will be the correct answer. Which data structure is used to convert expression from one form to another form? Now, what will be the answer for this one? So which data structure do we use to convert expression from one form to another form? Like is infix to prefix, prefix to postfix, postfix to prefix. So that's a very easy question. We use stack for it, right? We use stack for it. What is the mathematical function to use to round off 6.23 to 7? Now you can see we are incrementing the value, like increment is involved, 6.23 to 7. So we use seal function for it. Right, so that is clear. Now there is two syntaxes for seal given, this one and this one. So which one is correct? Obviously this one. It is seal will take only one argument where you have to specify the number that has to be rounded off. So this will be the option D will be the correct answer. Okay, now let's come to our coding part. So the question says, given a string S, input consisting of star and hash. Okay, the length of the a string is variable. Your task is to find out the minimum number of stars or hash to make it a valid string. Now, what is a valid string according to them? So let's understand this as well. Okay, so the string is considered valid if the number of star and hash are equal. So you can say a string is valid only if the number of star and the hash given in that string are equal. And also this string consists of hash and star only. They have specified the same in the starting only, right? The hash and star can be at any position in the string. Okay, so the output will be a positive or negative integer based upon the number of hash and star in the input. So if the number of star is greater than that of hash, then the output will be a positive integer. If the number of hash is greater than that of star, then output will be a negative integer. And if hash and star are equal, then the output will be zero. So this is what the question is. For example, here you can see even one example is there for our help to understand it. So you can see here we are having three hash and three star. So star and hash are equal. So that's why you can see in the output we are having zero. If we are having something like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, hash. So here you can see the number of star is 4 and the number of hash is 2. So 2 will be our answer, because you can see what is the difference, right? What is the difference between the star and hash? That is 2. So 2 will be our answer. If we were having something like this, 1, 2, 3 and star, so number of star is 1 and number of hash is 3. So answer will be what? Negative 2. Right. So the question is very easy. I hope you must have understood the question. So let's have a look on that code part. Basically, let me tell you logic itself. So first of all, what we'll be doing is we'll be counting the number of hash and the number of star present in our string, in the given string. And later on, we'll be simply printing the count of star minus count of hash. So if both are equal, the output will be, you know, like if subtracting the equal values, the output will be zero. If a star is greater than that of hash, the output will be a positive value. If the star is lesser than that of hash, then the output will be a negative value. So that's the complete logic of this question. Hope that is clear to you. So without much ado, let's jump to the coding part. So first of all, we have to take the array as the sorry the string as input, right? So we'll be taking that as input. So let's do that, scanf, and s is the name that I've provided. Now we'll be simply looping through the complete string. So either you can use the length of the string by using the string.h header file, and from which you can use a strlen function. Otherwise, you know that the string is eliminated by a special character that is known as null character. So you have to continue in this loop till the time we are encountering a null character in our string. So till the time s of I is not equal to null character, you have to continue in this loop and keep on incrementing the value of I. Also here, we have to count the star as well as hash. So we can take something like this, count star equal to 0 and count hash equal to 0. So initially they both are 0. Now here we'll be checking that if s of I is equal star, so we have to increment the value of count star. Else if we'll be checking that if s of I is equal hash, so we'll be incrementing the value of count hash, right? And here at the last, what we have to do is we have to simply print f the difference of star to that of difference of star to that of hash, right? So let's run our code. Okay, is there something? Okay, and it's just a warning. Let's see. No. Okay, so what we have to do is, or let me do, it's just that we have put here this double quotes, right? So as if this is a character, so we have to use single quote here. That's what they are saying. So let's do accordingly. Right, I think there should be no warning now. Yeah, it's gone. So hash, star, star, star. So you can see as if the number of hash, the count of hash and the count of star is similar, we are getting 0 as the output. Let's run it again. If we are giving 4 star, let's say 2 hash. So you can see we're getting 2, a positive value. And if we are taking hash and then just 1 star, so you can see we are getting a negative value. Right, so this was the complete code for the question that we just discussed. Hope that is clear for you. Now let's discuss our next coding question. Okay, so here's the next question: that given an integer array arr of size n, your task is to find out the count of elements whose value is greater than all of its prior elements. First element of the array should be considered in the count of the result. For example, 7, 4, 8, 2, 9. You have basically what they're saying is that you have an integer array of size n, and you count the or also and you have to do what? You have to do the count of all those elements whose value is greater than that of all its prior elements, or we can say the all of the elements which are occurring before it. So here's an example, 7, 4, 8, 2, 9. In case of 7, you know that in case of 7, there is no element prior to it. So it will always be considered, or we can say the leftmost element will always be considered because there's no element prior to it. Then we have 4. So you 4 won't be considered because you can see 7 is greater than that of 4. So it is not satisfying the criteria. Then we have 8. So you can see 8 is greater than all the elements which has occurred before it, that is 7 and 4. So 8 will be counted. Then 2, again 2 is not satisfying the criteria. Then 9. In case of 9, you can see 9 is greater than that of all the elements which has occurred prior to it, that is 7, 4, 8, 2. So how many number of elements are satisfying the criteria? 7, 8, and 9. And hence we can see the output is 3. The same is given in the explanation, even that as 7 is the first element, so it will consider in the result. 8 and 9 are also the elements that are greater than all of its previous elements. Since total of 3 elements is present in the array, that meets the condition. So hence, what is our output? 3 is our output, right? Okay, I hope that is clear. Let's take one more example. So here you can see the 5 is what? 5 is given as a, so in the input, what you'll be having in the input, it's just an example given. This is the actual input that is provided. So in the input, first of all, we'll be having the size of array, then the array elements. So 5 is the size of array. So it's the same thing is given here, okay, in the like input format and all, right? So I hope the question statement is clear. Let's see. Okay, so one more example is also given, that 3, 4, 5, 8, 9 are the array elements. So leftmost is always going to be considered, so count will be 1. Then we have 4. So 4 is satisfying the criteria. Yes, it is satisfying the criteria because 4 is greater than that of 3, the element which is prior to it. So count will be 2. Then 5 is also satisfying the criteria because you can see 3 and 4, which are occurring before 5, they are smaller than that of 5. So count will be 3. Then again, 8 also satisfying the criteria because it is greater than that of all the elements which has occurred prior to it. So count will be 4. Then 9 is also satisfying the criteria because it is greater than that of all the elements which has occurred prior to it. So the count will be 5. And you can see that's why we are getting 5 in the output. Now I guess the question is pretty much clear to all of you. The most basic and I should say the brute force approach that will come into your mind for solving this problem is that what we can do is we can take a big O and square approach. So we can take a loop int I equal to 0. I less than n, I plus plus, right? And then what we'll be doing is that if suppose on this element we are, so we'll be checking the element prior to it. We'll be checking the element prior to it. So we'll be taking int j equal to I minus 1 because ith element we are not going to consider. If suppose your ith element is 4, so 4 we are not going to consider. We are going to check the prior element. So continuing this loop till the time j value is greater than or equal to 0, j minus minus. So here we'll be checking is that if a of j, it means a prior element, the element which has occurred before, is greater than that of a of I, it means it is not satisfying the criteria. So we'll be taking a flag variable. We can do what? We can take a flag variable, initialize. Initially, we'll be taking it as 1. But if this criteria met, that is, the prior element is greater than that of the current element on which you are, so we'll be updating the value of flag as 0. And also, we'll be breaking the loop because there is no use to continue further in the loop. And once this hasn't satisfied the criteria, it means this won't be considered. This won't be considered in our, like, in the count that we are basically doing. Okay? So if that is the case, so we'll be just updating the value of flag and we'll be breaking out of the loop. And here, just coming out of this loop, we can simply check that if flag value is still equal 1, so we have to take a count variable even. So we'll be taking a count variable, initializing this with 0. So increment the value of c. Let me take you through this loop. So you know that 7 or basically the leftmost element will always be considered. So in case of leftmost, we won't be even moving inside this loop, and hence flag value will not be updated. Nothing will happen to flag value. It will remain as it is. So this leftmost element will always be considered, right? So let me take you. So I equal to 0, I less than n. What is the value of n? 5. Yeah, suppose we are taking this array only, 7, 4, 8, 2, 9, right? Then I value is what as of now? 0. 0 minus 1. So minus 1 greater than equal to 0? No, right? Okay. Flag value we have taken here is as 1. So here we'll be checking if flag equal 1. Yes, it is. So C value will be incremented. So C value is going to be 1 now. Now I value will be 1. So flag value we have updated, like flag value we have taken it as 1. So why we are just putting this flag here? So that we can update the value of flag for every ith value. We have to make the assumption for every ith value that flag is 1. But if any such case occur, we are updating the value of flag as z. So j equal to 1 minus 1, I value is 1, right? So 1 minus 1 will be 0. 0 greater than equal to 0, condition is true. Now here we are checking that if a of j, means a of 0, which is 7, is greater than that of a of I, which means 4. Because I value is 1, a of 1 is 4. 7 greater than that of 4, yes it is. So we are updating the value of flag as 0 and we are breaking the loop. Now here we'll be checking if flag equal 1. Is it so? No, right? So C value will remain as it is. Then I value will be what? 2. And we'll be moving inside this J loop. So J value will be what? 1. 1 greater than equal to 0? Yes, the condition is 2. So we'll be checking that if E of J is greater than that of E of I, No, right? Because 4 is not greater than that of 8. Then j value will be decremented. So 7 greater than that of 8. No, right? So nothing will happen. Now, after coming out of this for loop, we can check. We are checking that if flag is equal 1, yes, it is, because this condition never became true. So count value will be updated to 2 now. Then I value will be 2. So in case of 2, now I value will be what? 2. So I value, okay. I value 2 has already been done. I value will be 3. Okay, sorry. I value will be 3. So j value will be what? J value will be 3 minus 1, that is 2 now. So 2 greater than equal to 0, yes, the condition is true. So we are checking if a of 2, that is 8, is greater than that of a of i. A of i is what? 2. So a of j is what? 8. 8 is greater than that of true 2. Yes, it is. So flag value will be updated to 0. Right, because you can see this 2 is not satisfying the criteria. 2 is not greater than that of its prior elements, right? So flag value will be 0 and we will be breaking out of the loop. Now here we are checking if flag equal 1. No, it is not, because here this condition became true and flag has been updated to 0 now. Okay, then I value will be what? 4. I value will be what? 4. Now we are moving inside this for loop. So j value will be what? 3. So we are checking if a of j means 2. So 2 is greater than that of 9? No. Then for 8, we are going to check. 8 greater than that or greater than that of 9? No. 4 greater than that of 9? No. 7 greater than that of 9? No. So this condition never became true. After coming out of this loop, we are simply checking if flag equal 1. Yes, it is. So c value will be incremented to 3. So this is how this particular loop is working, or this particular logic is working. Now, what is the time complexity for it? You can see we are having two loops, and right. So what is the time complexity for this one? Big of n square. Can we do some sort of optimization? Can we come up with a better approach than this one? Of course we can. So let's understand another approach that we can follow to solve this particular question. So now what other thing, or like another logic that we can come up with, is that what we can do, that we are having elements 7, 4, 8, 2, 9. So we can keep track of the maximum left element that we have seen by now. One thing is clear, that leftmost element will always going to be considered. So we can say that maximum left that we have seen by now is that this first element of the array. Let's suppose your array is A. So A of 0 is the maximum left that has been seen by now. And initialize the count value as 1, because this leftmost element is going to be considered, and we have already considered it, right? So now we'll be taking our loop starting from int I equal to 1, I less than n, I plus plus. Now here we'll be checking that if A of I, let's suppose your array name is A, is greater than that of max left, the leftmost max that you have seen by now. If it is greater than that of leftmost left, or if it is greater than that of maximum left that you have seen by now, it means that it is satisfying the criteria. So first of all, we'll be updating the value of max left as A of I, and we'll be incrementing the value of count as well. So C++ we are going to do. And that's it. So time complexity for this one, it's a single loop we are using, right? So linear time, big of n. Let me take you through this loop itself so that you can get a proper understanding that what is actually happening. So we know that this leftmost element is always going to be considered. So we took the value of count as 1 itself, because this will be considered. And as of now, the maximum left value that you have seen by now is just this 7. So we are initializing the value of max left as a of 0, which is nothing but 7. Now we are taking a loop from int I equal to 1 up to I less than n, I plus plus. Now we are checking if a of I, it means this one, 4, is it greater than that of 7? No, right? So nothing will happen. Then 8 is greater than that of 7. So if there's any element which is greater than that of maximum left value, it means it will be greater than that of all the elements which are present at the maximum, which are present at the left, right? It is for sure. So maximum left value we are going to update as 8 now. So max left value will be what? 8 now, and count will be incremented by 1. So count will be 2 now. Then we have 2. Is 2 greater than that of max left value, the maximum left value which we have seen by now, which is nothing but 8? Is 2 greater than that of 8? No, right? So nothing will happen. Then we have 9. So is 9 greater than that of the maximum left value that we have seen by now? that is 8. So yes, it is. So maximum left value will be updated to 9 and count value will be incremented. So count will be 3 now. And as if we have gone through all the elements, so we will come out of the loop and you can see by this approach as well, we got our output and the time complexity has also been improved by using that particular approach. So I hope that both the approaches that we discussed is clear to you. If it is so, then let's quickly jump to the coding part. Right. I won't be telling you the code for the first approach because that is pretty much clear. I wrote the complete code for even the first approach. I'll be writing the code for this optimized approach, right? Okay, well, let me do one thing. Let me write the code for both the approaches because as if this is recorded, so in case if there will be any doubts, you won't be able to reach out to me. So I'm explicitly taking the input, you know that how to take the input and all. So I'm not doing this. You can take this by yourself, right? I'm explicitly taking the output that input that was given in the test case also. So yeah, right. So here we are having, let's put 7, 4, 8, 2, 9. So now we have to take, first of all, I'm discussing the first approach that we discussed with big O of N time complexity. Sorry, big O of N is square, right? Big O of N was done for the next one. And here int j equal to I plus one. Okay. It will be j equal to I minus one. Prior element we have to check. J greater than equal to zero, j minus minus. Here we'll be checking that if the prior element is, okay, the array I have taken is arr. If the prior element is greater than that of the current element, it means, so for this also, we have to take a variable that int flag, initially we are taking it as 1, but if this condition met, so we are updating the value of flag as 0, also we are breaking the loop. After coming out of this breath loop, we can check that if flag is equal to 1. So for count also I have to take a variable. So count initialized by 0. If flag is equal 1, so what we can do is we can update the value of count as count plus plus. And after coming out of this all the loops, we can simply print the value of count. Right. So this is in C++. It's just, you know, like almost everything is going to be the same in C as well. Instead of the C out, you have to write printf. So I don't think that it will create any problem for you. Let's run it. Okay. Is there somewhere? Okay. It was count. I by mistake wrote C out. So you can see we are getting 3 as the output, right? So this is what the expected output was. So this is the first approach with the time complexity of big O of N square. Let's discuss our next approach. So let's discuss that even. So for this one, we'll be taking a count as 1. We'll be taking one more variable, max initialize. So here is the array element. So we'll be taking max, initializing this with arr of 0 with the leftmost element, and then we'll be doing int I equal to 1, I less than n, I plus plus. So I plus plus. Here we'll be checking that if arr of I is greater than that of max element that we have seen. So max value we are going to update as arr of I. Also, we are going to increment the value of count. So that's pretty much what we are going to do. So you can see here is just one single loop that we have used, right? So just have a look on the complete code. Now let's run the code. So you can see we are getting 3. If you want, you can just print the elements even to be sure that we are getting the correct answer. So let me do this as well for you. So, okay, and here let me include an handle for the next line. So you can see, I missed that semicolon. Let's run it again. So you can see for 7, For 7, we are not going to move inside just because you know we have already taken the 7 in consideration due to which count is 1. And for other values, that is 8 and 9 is contributing in the criteria that is given in the question. So we are getting the expected output, right? Hope it is clear for you. These were the two approaches. You can go with any because as said, there is no time constraint that has been specified for TCS NQT exam. For distal, there is a time constraint. Obviously, you have to come up with the optimized solution. That's why I discussed both the approaches for you. So, yeah, this is it for this video, guys. Thank you so much for watching this video, guys. Keep learning, keep preparing. Bye-bye and keep practicing, right? All these things you are going to learn if you're practicing. So, keep practicing. Thank you so much. Bye, everyone.